Welcome to another round table, and this is She Leads. We've got an incredible group of women, and I'm going to jump straight in with Chris Pringle.
Daughter.
Mama Chris.
Yes.
This is the 20th anniversary of Every Woman.
I know, it's so exciting.
Well, what do you think has been like a flavour or something that would describe the movement over the last 20 years?
Well, I would have to say that it's been my dream and our dream as Every Woman to not just to lead every woman, but to release women of all generations in the conference and out beyond in their local churches or working in the community. That's been a big passion of mine. And the funny thing is, a couple of years ago, Sheila Walsh was here and she was at Every Woman. And out in the green room, she said to me at the end of the conference, "I was so shocked to see that you weren't just doing everything, that you got all these women up to tell their story and to lead and to receive the offerings." And I went, "Oh, isn't that normal?" And she said, "No, it's not." It just confirmed to me this is, Pastor Phil has always said to us that whatever you're doing, you should be in doing yourself out of a job, not so that you're going away, you know, not she leads but she leaves, no, but that you are raising women up for them to find their purpose. And I think that's been the call and the mission underneath all the fun and everything we have of Every Woman.
And how do you see that changing over the next 10 to 15 years? Because when you started, doesn't it look different to how it is now?
Yes.
So what do you see?
Oh, well, look, it's the weirdest thing. It's kind of like I see that there's going to be, the gatherings that are bigger, but they're going to be multiplied in different regions of C3 churches and out beyond. I mean, I like to think that women will come into the gathering, leaders and pastors, and when we come to She Leads at Presence as well, that leaders will understand everything starts small. And the gathering, the conference, started as women's small groups.
Wow.
And I believe that it's both. I see in the future that there's going to be the gatherings where we all come together, but they're going to come out of growing week by week, month by month in our different areas, wherever a woman is planted, wherever the church is planted, and then she's going to bring those women with her to the gathering, whether it's in Sydney, whether it's in the States, whether it's in England, whether it's in New Zealand, whether it's in Europe. And I see that in the future because people are wanting to go more local,
right?
Really like
true.
To travel and the expense and time. Poor people are time poor. I think that in the future we're going to see the gathering multiplied.
Well, there's people at this table who have probably, Vicky, you might have been at the first one. Were you or the first 5 years? And look at you now.
Don't hold it against us. Just gotta say something.
The first one that I came to, I actually spoke at because I've only actually been a part of C3 for the last 9 years. So
that's right.
Women dreaming.
Because we did a little thing in the
the little journals.
Yeah. I was in Girl Dreamer, but,
you were just in Little Girl Dreamer. Well, you are, you see, the fulfilment of every woman. There was Charlotte in as a little
there
dreamer.
There was me starting to come to the church.
Yes.
Vicky was speaking.
Yep.
And Vicky, how do you feel that you're carrying this when you go and speak to other women around the country? Do you think that there is a common thread that women need to hear?
I do, and I think it's that they count. You know, that because I believe for the most part, women want to be valued. They want to know that they matter.
Yes.
Actually, it's interesting what Chris said about, her vision to release others and to activate others. That's what I carry. You know, I carry that, that same... that same mission, that same
the
passion.
DNA.
So
how do you do that in your ministry when you want a woman to actually get that message when what she's getting at home is different to that? How do you pass that through?
Well, just purely by just, consistently declaring the truth. My voice is just a part of the picture, And you just hope that what you're doing is somehow countering that, you know, that the scales are tipping, mm. You know, towards the truth of her value and that mm. and that she has a voice and that she should be heard, that, you know, she has a right to be heard mm. and she has a valuable contribution to make. So absolutely, you know, people are in all sorts of different environments mm. and not all of them positive or edifying or you know, uplifting. But, yeah, I just, you know, persistently declare the truth.
Yeah. That's great.
And because Vicky's got that prophetic voice.
Yes.
Which I love. And so she brings that to the table mm-hmm. of she leads or wherever she goes to preach mm. or wherever she goes to minister. And that is a part of who we are. We're mm. not just one dimension.
Right.
We are many dimensions mm. and
yeah,
expressions.
That's great.
And that's definitely something in the future that I mm. value and, mm. and nurture and see. That, mm. you know, I'm 65 now. By the time I turn 70, I want to just see that multiple expression of creativity mm. Across every woman, across mm. not just the conference, mm. but in every time we gather for She Leads, mm. You know, across the country and beyond, that we see that there is, oh my gosh, look at that prophetic mm. gift that Vicky mm. released in that young woman when she was 12. Mm. Now she's living in it. She's walking in that gift.
And it's all the things that you can't necessarily do yourself or continue to do yourself.
Oh, you can't. You
shouldn't. And it's having that multiplying
yeah,
effect, isn't
have
it?
Have that multiplying.
Joe, similarly, with your background with the anti-slavery, mm-hmm. now as a full-time pastor, how do you see those worlds colliding?
Yeah, well, up until around a year ago, I was working as a human rights lawyer and, you know, really did see incredible. The mm-hmm. extreme end of mm-hmm. women and men, actually, suffering because of exploitation, whether that be trafficking or forced labour, particularly in the area that I was involved with, enforced marriage. And women mm. weren't having a voice, they weren't being heard. And I really sensed that, you know, there's just seeing their pain and suffering there made me realise that, because I'd really wanted to be on the front lines and, you know, I had that opportunity. But I really felt the Lord speaking to me about the fact that the church is the front line.
Right.
And that what we can do is we can stand with women mm. in their pain mm. and acknowledge that. I think it's important to acknowledge that. But the other thing that we do is we bring something that the world can't bring. We can bring the hope of Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so for me, that's what I see. I can come alongside somebody who walks in our doors on a Sunday at church and stand alongside of her, pray with her, and help her find her voice and
right,
be
right.
released.
Yeah.
And so that for me is just an exciting thing to do for us as the church, as the global church.
Mm. It's amazing, honestly.
Mm,
we're. And we wanted to ask you, as with the rise of the Me Too movement, and we're seeing parallels of life, of course, in church reflected in what's happening in the world. How do you see that impacting your church and your ministry?
Look, I think what Me Too says to me is that there's a lot of hidden pain or pain
right.
that's not being able to be expressed by people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that social media, for all its pros and cons, mm-hmm. one of the things that it enables people to do mm-hmm. is in a simple way to be able to be heard.
Right.
And so I think a campaign like Me Too has given voice to people's pain. And I think it's important for us as the church to actually recognise that and be part of the
of
the conversation, not be scared about the conversation.
Right.
So I think that that's important.
Mm.
And I think also just, again, like it's just, for me, I think helping women or helping people to actually locate their identity in Christ.
Wonderful.
So that's where I think that we've really got a special role to play.
Yeah. Mm. Well, it's funny you say that because I know that's one of your hot buttons, Mish, isn't it, helping people find their identity? Can you tell us your thoughts about that?
I guess I'm sort of exploring, starting this project called Stories Worth Telling and photographing and telling stories of everyday people who are living a life of purpose. I think sometimes we have these role models, like this view of role models where someone's famous or someone's rich. And it's kind of really unattainable for the majority of people. Whereas I think you know, everyday people. Like, I know of this cleaner in our strata building, and he cleans. He's always so cheerful. Mm. And it's like people like that, and it's not a fake, you know, thing. Yeah. And there's something in there, something that he's gone through in life that is a story that's worth telling. As you said, Jo, social media can be very vicious at times, but wanting to actually use social media and spread some good stories, like, wonderful. You know, and just hopefully with the passion of maybe even, you know, every day in someone in their life just thinking for a minute or even a second going, what is my purpose in life? What is, what am I put on earth to do? Mm. So, yeah.
So with your line of work, we were talking earlier about how you've been able to bring two worlds together, your well-paid career in a proper corporate environment with your passion. Mm. So how do we do that and still be able to pay the bills?
Wow. Well, I have to say, you know, this is my journey and I God's created me this way. So I did electrical engineering degree, did IT, worked in a corporate investment bank, and then kind of thought there's more to life than that. I don't want to sit and solve problems, but actually, you know, what is my passion? And it's not to go crazy, but actually just to be a good steward of your money and also be a good steward of the gifts that God's given you. Like I read this verse actually from the Message version in Galatians 6:4-5, and it says, you know, make a careful explanation of what God's given you and who you are, and then do your creative best. So it's kind of like, you know, what works for you, Vicky, is not going to be the same for me. But I know that God's actually, when I sit there and go, you know, why am I doing what I'm doing now? I kind of go, well, God's gifted me in the corporate and the analytical mind, but also in the creative. And and so I have to do something. And now I've realized that, you know, having left the corporate work and starting a photography business, I realized that I can't actually operate without having a balance of both.
Yeah. Was it a step-by-step process that of you leaving the corporate?
I have a bit of, I love finance and I love working a spreadsheet. As much as I love being behind the camera and being creative.
You're a sick person. You're a sick person.
Extremes. No, it's quite sad, but I will admit that. And so I knew that there was that inkling in me. I was like spending spare time going, oh, this business podcast, something makes me tick, you know. So I kind of thought, look, you know what can I do? Oh, I love photography. I love taking photos. So let's see how that goes. And so it's like testing it out slowly and little bit. And I had a bit of a buffer. Actually, I had a quite a long bit of buffer, but also just being wise with my money. And so, like, I think Anna and I were talking earlier, like how...
The world's apart.
Well, you know, give me your credit card.
I know. I'm like, buy now, pay later. And she's think about it first, put the money away.
Well, you know, everyone's so different. So it's like, you know, like I budgeted well and I guess live simply. So I was fortunate, I think, you know, you've been a uni student for a long time and then you suddenly get your first paycheck, you could easily just spend it. But I just kind of had that, I'm going to put aside some.
Good advice. And that is such good advice, you know, as women who lead, that's good advice because a lot of people step out and then they're, you know, in terrible debt to fulfill the dream that God gave them.
Right. Yes.
So that's really good wise. Yes. She leads counsel.
Why am I feeling convicted?
And I think there's so many more opportunities now because we're not expected to leave school, start one career and do that thing for the next 40 years. Oh, and so, I mean, I was a little bit similar, you know, working in the corporate world and, you know, really interested in voiceovers and so got into that. But I mean, I've had a home studio for the last 20 years and, I mean, it's been wonderful, do a lot of that work at night. And so it's enabling when we look at sort of think laterally about how we can follow our dreams.